Following the rights movement to clamp down with your iron fist. Drugs became conveniently available for all the kids. Following the rights movement to clamp down with your iron fist. Drugs became conveniently available for all the kids.
Mother, my crack, my smack, my bitch, right here in Hollywood.
Nearly 2 million Americans are incarcerated in the prison system of the U.S.
They're trying to build a prison.
They're trying to build a prison.
Sell your prisons, you don't even flinch. All our taxes paying for your wars against the new non-rich. Minor drug offenders, sell your prisons, you don't even flinch. All our taxes paying for your wars against the new non-rich.
Mother, my crack, my smack, my bitch, right here in Hollywood.
The percentage of Americans in the prison system, has doubled since 1985.
They're trying to build a prison.
Hey, good evening, everyone. John with the Missouri Liberty Report. I have Brandon Daugherty with me. So in just a moment, we're going to start the recording. We'll get the show started. Sorry for a late start. Some idiot, won't say who has two thumbs and screws up the other person being able to contact them on Skype. This guy right here. So anyway, let me get the recording started. We'll get right into the conversation with Brandon Daugherty, who is running for U.S. House out of Missouri District Number 2.
In the restaurant of life, we're putting freedom back on the menu. It's the Missouri Liberty Report with John Williams, working with grassroots organizations and legislatures to make Missouri the freest state in the nation. Let freedom ring.
All right, folks, and we are back with another edition of the Missouri Liberty Report. Thanks so much for joining me once again. To all of you who were looking forward to the show last week that went awry, I did get Michael Rechtenwald rescheduled. He will be joining me on the 26th, so not next Friday, but the following Friday. Let's hope that he doesn't have any more urgent business and that we can get him on and have a nice long conversation with a former NYU professor, someone who was kind of a proclaimed Marxist and went completely the opposite direction and became a libertarian. Looking forward to that. All right, tonight with me, I was almost said in the house, but he's not in the house. He's in his house. But it's Brandon Daugherty, who's running for U.S. Congress. He's running for the U.S. House out of the 2nd Missouri District. He's a libertarian guy. And you know, folks, for the most part, I've interviewed a lot more conservatives than libertarians here in the last year plus, and I figured it's time to make a little bit of a change here in who we're interviewing on this show. So, first of all, Brandon, welcome to the show, and if you would be so kind, give us a little bit of your background, a little bit of your history, and then why you chose to run for U.S. House of Representatives.
Hey, John, thanks for having me. I have lived in St. Charles County basically my whole life. I grew up in Lake Sherwood, Missouri, which is kind of out in the middle of nowhere in between Wentzville and Washington, and then moved to St. Charles City when I was in middle school. I graduated from St. Charles West High School. I graduated from St. Charles Community College. And I do a lot of hunting and fishing. I decided to run for office because I'm just so fed up with the corruption in the two-party system. Basically, all of Democrats and most Republicans have sold themselves out, on the federal level especially, to the donor class, the big pharma, the oil companies, the military-industrial complex, and the big banks and investment firms. They have banded together to purchase our legislators through lobbying efforts, through their campaigns and super PACs, and the revolving door that is the public-private sector. You see different legislators and different members of cabinets and different other officials. They go on to become board members of large corporations like Raytheon, Lockheed Martin. And so, you know, I'm just fed up. I decided to run because I didn't feel like in the Republican Party I would be given a fair chance, and then as well as in the and I haven't been a There's no way I could run as a Democrat. They're just too far gone. I actually, funny enough, my dad was a union rep for UAW. He worked in the union. And so my family grew up rooting for Democrats. I grew up rooting for Democrats basically up until 2016. And then whenever I started doing my own research out of the house, you start seeing, you know, how the world really works and where the money goes.
Yeah, so, you know, that's funny that you say that because I also work in a union factory, but I also am not naive enough to think that they're perfect. And yes, they do try to get me to vote for Democrats, which I absolutely refuse to do. Now, I should say that I can't say that I would never vote for a Democrat, but they would have to be coming out of the classical liberal train of thought, not the current day liberal mindset. But if you had a classic liberal that came and ran as a Democrat, it's a very good chance I would vote for them because they're not out of their minds. They're not like every day's trying out a new drug to see how stupid they can get in a short period of time. So that's about the only way. But I can also say that for a lot of Republicans, I don't want to vote for them either because they just seem like a lot of them are Democrat light anymore. That's the only way I know how to put it. It seems like they're Democrat light. They like big government, but just in a different way than Democrats like big government. That's not all of them, but I would have to say that that's a majority of them seem to feel that way.
I think the FISA vote that happened earlier today proves that.
I didn't see how that turned out. I hadn't seen how that turned out. I'm guessing they didn't want the warrants, but they want the expanded searches. They got it.
It was actually a split vote in the House, 214 to 214, and then it failed because it was split. And Mike Johnson was one of the deciding votes, and you got to read what he said earlier this week. Like I remember him saying something about being against it. And then, or maybe it was earlier today or earlier this week, he was saying that he was like, well, I had an inside meeting with the intelligence community, and now I understand why this is so important. And I don't buy that for a second.
Yeah, I would think that if you saw it, you know, if one of us two, if the intelligence agencies came to us and said, well, this is why we think you should change your mind, I'm feeling like there's a death threat involved or something, but no one's going to give me any intelligence to say, oh, yeah, sure, that seems completely okay to go ahead and just, you know, go ahead and just spy on everybody. Do it, well, no warrants, just willy-nilly do as you please.
It's especially with the distrust with those agencies nowadays. Like with Crossfire Hurricane, where they openly were spying on members of Trump's campaign. That's why he came out against it. I'm sure he was like, he posted something on Truth Social, kill FISA. It's what they used to spy on me, which is why I was surprised so many Republicans voted for this, because I mean, I know that the Republican Party is a lot split even on Trump, but he's, by and large, you know, most Republicans support him. So I just blows my mind that so many would go against what he wants on FISA, let alone what against, I'm sure, a lot of people who understand what FISA is go against.
You know, and that's the thing that gets me about Trump is he's coming out against FISA because, again, you know, they used the FISA courts against him. But he's openly said, I want to build the FBI a bigger building. Why would you build a bigger building for one of the agencies who openly just, you know, they were against you? 10 ways to Sunday, but like, I'm going to make them a big, like, you think you're going to appease these people? You think because you build them a bigger building, they won't turn on you the moment you don't do what they want you to do? That just seems so naive and really dim-witted. It's such a dim-witted thing to do.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, I'm not going to get into Trump too hard, just because I don't think for the race I'm running in particular, I'm only going to be, unless they give me some awesome committee assignment, which I'm doubting that either whoever controls the House, the Democrats or the Republicans, are going to give me too many committee assignments worth value. I mean, my race is going to be voting yay and nay out of what comes out of the House. And as much as I, as a libertarian, there are a lot of things that you could look at Trump and question, but it's hard not to root for him sometimes with how much pressure he gets from, you know, all the indictments and all of the, how rallied against he is by all the establishment forces that I don't like. They're also don't like him. So it's hard not to find yourself rooting for him a lot, but yeah. he just does a lot of things where it makes you wonder. The biggest one for me was when he put John Bolton when he brought in John Bolton, one of the biggest war hawks of all time, was a big war hawk all throughout the Bush administrations, was doing the whole pony show for the Iraq war and Afghanistan war. And he's just famous for blunders. And Trump put him on his advisory team for foreign policy. And just, it's things like that where you're just like, man, what are you doing?
Yeah. He was supposed to be this outside of the normal establishment type of guy, but he surrounded himself with some of the most awful people you could find. It's like, what are you, you're supposed to be draining the swamp and you're dragging the swamp creatures in with you. Yeah, like you're talking John Bolton, some of them. You know, I think, you know, if Trump was to win again, I'd like to see someone like Colonel Douglas McGregor be his guy for the military, because McGregor is a no-nonsense guy. He's not going to want to, oh, let's go bomb these people and do this. I would love to see him be the Secretary of Defense or whatever, a McGregor type of guy. Would we get that? It's hard to say.
Right.
But it does boggle the mind as far as how the people he surrounds himself with. It's hard to trust the guy when you see this type of behavior, because you're like, what are you doing, dude?
If I'm not mistaken, his first Secretary of State pick was Rex Tillerson, who was the CEO of ExxonMobil. Just on its face, that's not a good look. You know, it's part of that revolving door where the big CEOs end up in cabinet positions and cabinet positions end up as the board of CEOs. It's the same thing. You're just, even on its face, like at face value, you can look in that and go, that doesn't seem right. You would think you'd want someone who would have a little less corporate interest in mind whenever you're picking, especially going as the guy who's fighting the establishment.
Right.
Strange choices sometimes. And what I think really hurt Trump in the 2020 election was when he sat down, he let somebody in 2020 have like inside access at the request of Lindsey Graham. Like Lindsey Graham reached out to this author and then reached out to Trump and was telling him, hey, you need to let this guy in your life and write this book about you. And this guy starts leaking a bunch of stuff to the media and publishes stuff that like Trump was lying about COVID and knew he was lying about COVID, which he wasn't, at least not that I'm, you know, fervently aware of, that Trump was like on purposely lying about things, especially not the way Fauci and all of them were. But it's just strange that you would let someone who works in the establishment media trap you like that. It's just one of those things, like I said, it's one of those weird plays that where Trump does something and you're like, man, I'm just not, I don't understand it.
I'm not picking up what you're putting down, buddy.
Right.
So I guess since we're talking about, basically foreign, wars, just wars in general and our foreign policy, What are your thoughts on stuff like Ukraine and the Israel Israel Palestine conflict we've got going on? What are your thoughts on both of those conflicts and where, what role, if any, our government should be playing in these conflicts?
I'll start by saying I think on both conflicts, I think the United States should not be giving military support to either Ukraine or Israel. As a principle alone, that these countries are not, we haven't declared war on either Russia or the people of Palestine. And I don't think that it's in the Constitution that we should be sending money overseas without an imminent threat, without a declaration of war to build up, you know, a militia. That's what the Constitution says, and it's not there. But also, I'll start with Ukraine. I don't think the conflict in Ukraine started in 2022, in February 2022. I believe it started in February of 2014. And I believe that was when the United States, in my opinion, I think the United States had a big hand in the revolution that took place in 2014. A big part of that is the released audio from Victoria Nuland, who was the assistant secretary of state for European affairs at the time. And she was caught on a phone call with a high up inside of the Ukrainian government at the time, discussing who she wanted to see in charge. So then fast forward to February 20th of 2014, there's a sniper fire that rings out from a building that is supposedly affiliated with the right sector, that's sector with a K, and they were a neo-Nazi group in Ukraine. And they had apparently were firing sniper fires during the Euromaidan protests. So I guess it's called the Euromaidan Revolution. Well, during these protests leading up to it, a sniper was firing out of a building, trying to stir up the crowd and cause chaos. So then it worked, of course, because he was firing at both police officers and members of the Russian-friendly regime, and members of the crowd were fired on by the same sniper. So he was just trying to stir the pot, which worked, because 2 days later, a bunch of armed neo-Nazis busted into a bunch of government buildings and overthrew the current president of Russia. I think his name was Yanukovych. He fled, and a bunch of his officials had to flee because a bunch of neo-Nazis showed up with guns. And then Victoria Nuland, along with the EU, came up with a plan. It's not authorized by the Ukrainian constitution in any way, but they just came up with a plan to make the person that Victoria Nuland had mentioned on the phone that she wanted to be the new prime minister, lo and behold, he becomes the prime minister. So then starting in 2014, the government that was installed started waging attacks on the Donbass region. And then also one of Russia's biggest naval bases is right outside of Crimea. So whenever they lost that region, whenever the coup happened in 2014, of course they were going to go take that peninsula. Not to mention that from all accounts that I've read, the people in Crimea, at least a large, large majority of them, both affiliate more with the Russians and wanted to join the Russian Federation in the first place. So them taking Crimea as a Russian aggression, I think, is totally overblown. I think once the president of Russia was no longer friendly, those people and that area decided they wanted to be Russian, because their government was overthrown. And a lot of the people in the eastern part of Russia were upset. And then they're fighting neo-Nazis. They're being shelled by the government. Of course, weapons that the United States then started selling to Ukraine. And then in 2022 is when Russia came in. And I'm not saying that Russia has good intentions, but there were definitely a lot of off-ramps that the United States blew past to get to where we are today. And the Russia is the only side arguing for peace. They're the ones who want to go to the table to negotiate peace. And it's the West that refuses to do it. They keep saying that if you negotiate with Putin, he's going to start taking the rest of Europe, which is blatantly not true. Because if you look at the line that's been drawn, where the Russians hold the line versus where the Ukrainians hold the line, those regions are all strategic regions for Russia. Russia is not trying to take over the rest of Europe. And so I think I think on those fallacies and for those reasons, that's why I would not support giving any more money to Ukraine, because too many people have died on both sides. It's not like Putin or Zelensky are suffering in this war. It's the conscripted soldiers and the young men from both of these countries who have families and jobs and left those to go fight in this war for these two corrupt entities.
Well, yes, and not to mention the fact that we, you know, even though, 59 different people, people from the State Department, former ambassadors and everything, sent a letter to our government and said, stop trying to expand NATO any further in these countries surrounding Russia. You're going to tick them off. They're going to get very mad. You're not going to like the consequences. And what do? We just, hey, Ukraine, you want to join NATO? That was the final straw. Now, again, like you said, I don't like it when one country invades another country, but the warning signs were there. They had been warned against their actions. And what do these neocons and these war hawks that we have in D.C. decide to do? Hey, let's push buttons. Let's push buttons and see what happens, because we have a lot of our friends in the military-industrial complex that need bigger contracts, and they need billions of dollars. Their stakeholders are getting mad, and my campaign funds are drying up. And so what if we start World War III? At least I get to hold my money and power, and I get more money, and I get more power. And the saddest thing to me is the amount of people, whether it's in social media or wherever, around this country, that just wholeheartedly just threw their support behind the Ukraine government, our government funding them, not only funding them with weapons, but literally paying the payrolls of the government positions in Ukraine. We're paying their payroll for them. And people are like, oh, well, we must save the Ukraine. What? Here's my question, Brandon. I'm not saying that you have the answer. This is kind of just a question. What the heck is in the Ukraine that the United States finds so important that they'd rather start World War III than act like competent and civilized adults?
I think what's interesting, two parts to that. I think what's interesting, one, is how many different former, like the sons and daughters and like the people who've been over to Ukraine to do business. I think one of John Kerry's relatives has been on a board of Ukraine. I think Nancy Pelosi, one of her kids has been on a board of Ukraine. Hunter Biden, of course, has been on the board of Ukraine. So I think there's some sort of political dynamic to, like, there's just these boards that you can get on in Ukraine to collect a bunch of money. Exactly how that works, I'm not sure, but that's one of just a gut reaction I have, seeing so many different, family members of U.S. officials becoming board members in Ukraine. And then secondly, on top of that, I think the congressmen are bought by the military-industrial complex to a large sum. So they're always going to try to benefit. I'm pretty sure that Lockheed Martin and Raytheon have both added $10 billion to their market value since 2022 when the war began. And I think their stock value has gone up. I think one went up like 25% or close to it, and the other one about 15%. So I think that's another big reason. And then also, if I'm not mistaken, right before the 2014, maybe I'm mistaken on this, but at some point in time, they found a bunch of oil reserves in Ukraine. I could be wrong about that, but I heard somewhere that there was large amounts of oil in Ukraine too, which could be another reason that the U.S. wants to get their hands on it.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many possibilities here. And somebody says human trafficking. I mean, human trafficking is unfortunately, in the world today, is a big moneymaker. And it makes you nauseous and want to vomit on your own shoes to say something like that. But to me, it's undeniable, pretty much, to say that folks in our government are not taking part in human trafficking. I don't think you're being, honest with yourself. You say, oh, well, there's no way anyone in government would be involved in this. The amount of human trafficking that goes on in this country, let alone the world, there's some power players at the top who are very much involved in this. Will we ever know exactly who they are? No, because we couldn't even see Epstein's client list. So, we don't really know for sure, but it's disgusting to think about. It's disgusting that a government that's supposed to be, of the people, by the people, for the people, would be involved in something like this. But anymore, when you look at the world, you just go, well, I you can't just take it and go, there's no way, and toss it out the window. You can't do it anymore. There's too much stuff that we see every day, disgusting behavior by elected people and then those that are appointed, that you can't just take any possibility and say, well, that's frivolous. That can't be true. These these people are dumb and weird, but they're not that dumb and weird. Like, no, no. You listen to Nancy Pelosi for 5 minutes. You can definitely see they're really dumb and weird. Okay, so let's go to the other conflict, Brandon. Let's talk about Israel and Palestine, because this has been going on for a long time. The U.S. Yes. has unabashedly just and very just forthcoming just saying, oh, Israel needs more stuff. Let's give it. I've heard one guy in Congress really who spoke out really well against this, and that was Ron Paul, saying, we don't have to, these people can take care of themselves. They don't need our money, and they don't need all these weapons and weapons of war. They're fine on their own. You get to Thomas Massie speaking out against these things too. But Ron Paul was, to me, the biggest one speaking out against this. But what are your thoughts on how our government has their hands all over the Israeli and Palestinian conflict?
Well, you know, what happened on October 7th was a terrorist attack by a terrorist group. And I think that's important to note that Hamas is more of a terrorist group than like the government organization inside of the Gaza region. It's incredibly complicated because, in my opinion, this is actually documented that the Israeli government was funding Hamas. They were, and they were also funding it before it was Hamas, when it was the Muslim Brotherhood, because that was a Sunni counterpart to the Shiite Palestinian Liberation Organization. So what they wanted was for those two sides to be at odds with each other. If one was Sunni and one was Shia, they would never get along. At least that's the premise behind it. And then also, if you look at the rights that even before Hamas's attack on Gaza, if you look at the structure of the way Gaza is, those people do not really have freedom. It's not like it's two separate states fighting each other. Israel controlled the water, the electricity, the cell tower information. Like, now that they've shut off the aid, there are millions of people at threat of starving to death. Millions of people, like, in danger of starving, or in the dire area of starvation. And I think, and another statistic is that even by Israeli standards, they've killed 13,000 Hamas members and have killed 33,000 people, which means that they've killed 22,000 civilians by their own metrics, by their numbers, which is insane considering if you take the 2-year war in Russia, only 10,000 civilians have died in that war. It's been going on for four times less long, and it's been taking place in Ukraine. So it's not like it's a war that's in Russia and Ukraine and 10,000 Ukrainian civilians got killed. No, 10,000 civilians got killed in Ukraine in a war that's happening in Ukraine, and more civilians have died in Gaza in 6 months. And I can't sponsor my weapons going to that in good conscience. I can't do it. I will never vote to send aid to Ukraine or to Israel while they continue this genocide. And I will say it's a genocide because they're killing more civilians than enemies, and their enemies are ones that they funded and supported for years.
No, I agree. I don't. Would you give me 1 second? I need to shut the door. I have a dog that keeps trying to get in the room.
Absolutely.
I got a pug that likes to sneak in the room on me all the time. And she wants to be in my lap, and then she doesn't want to stay there, and then she wants to bark all the time. No, you're right. It is a genocide. It's unfortunate to me that we have so many Christians who will ignore the genocide part of it, because there's this mindset that you have to support Israel no matter what. That's, you know, that kind of thinking got us to where we are now with our government, you know, our government, right or wrong. No, you don't have to abide these liars. You don't have to let them off the hook because they're a certain party that you affiliate with. That's how we got here today. Is my government right or wrong is the best government in the world. Okay, yeah. You have the highest prison population per capita. You're taxed to no end. They fund genocides. They fund proxy wars. They steal from you and give it to their friends. That is not a group of people who are looking out for you. And I don't know how, just because the other side isn't Israel, it's Palestine, that you have, that you just turn a blind eye to. I mean, yeah, how many aid workers have been killed? We just had an American killed here the other day. And then they're just dropping bombs indiscriminately. It's like, well, there might have been there might have been some Hamas people in there. Okay. The ratio is probably 100 to 1. One Hamas guy, 100 innocent civilians. And you're like, well, you know, you can't make an omelet without breaking a few eggs. It's truly disgusting. All right. So, next topic, since we're on government stealing from you and lying to you and everything else. Because we have this an article the other day, you know, they're trying to, it seems like sometimes they want to ramp up the fear with the bird flu. What are your thoughts on the whole COVID crisis, the stupidity that we went through for almost 3 years? What are your thoughts on how COVID was handled by either the federal government, state governments, and local governments with lockdowns, shutdowns, vaccine passports, and the like? What are your thoughts on all that?
I still think that it's one of the most egregious crimes that our government has not paid for is the fact that no one involved with the COVID lies and the vaccine lies and the masking lies, the social distancing lies. I think it's crazy that no one has actually been held accountable, that Anthony Fauci could lie to Congress about gain-of-function research and then not get in trouble for it. Those who preach that Donald Trump, oh, his hush money scandals, oh, there are a bunch of people involved with COVID. So what I found incredible is that there was a group of scientists who, there's a great video that Jimmy Dore does about it, but there was a bunch of scientists who all were getting together and saying that they think that COVID came from a lab, and this was pretty early on. And then the NIH gives them a bunch of funding, and lo and behold, their new study, after all of this funding comes out, was not a lab leak. They became inconclusive from one side to the other, which is just the tip of the iceberg. You know, I think it's crazy that the American people paid for the research for the vaccine and then paid Pfizer for the vaccine, and they got to collect all of the profits. I mean, we sold ourselves out, basically. Yeah. I think it's done an astronomical damage to our economy, and I think it's one of the biggest players as to why inflation is still this high. But I also attribute a lot of that to the wars.
Yeah, they certainly didn't help us with inflation by printing $6 trillion. Well, that's $6 trillion we know of, plus a whole lot. I think I've heard numbers really as high as $10 trillion. You know, dumping that much into the economy at one time, is it? And here's my favorite part, Brandon. When they said that they didn't expect any inflation, and then when it hit, they're like, it's transitory. Where's it transiting to? It's transiting to every freaking thing I buy at the store, and it's transiting a lot of money out of my wallet. And then the audacity, I don't know why I use the word audacity, because this is how these people operate. But it's, oh, it's not inflation. It's corporate greed. Really? So pumping trillions of dollars in the economy in one fell swoop, you expect me to believe that that's not going to affect the value of the fiat currency that I spend and then I get paid in? That has nothing to do with it. It's just these. Now, don't get me wrong. There are greedy corporations, and those greedy corporations are best friends with who? The federal government. They have best friends who make sure the regulations go their way to get rid of their competition. It's just not the greedy corporations that the government wants us to be mad at. It's a bunch of callous liars who needlessly destroyed the economy, drove suicides and overdoses through the roof, and then in other countries drove, you know, suffering by hunger. And then the numbers of people dying from tuberculosis and all these other diseases were on the decline. And then what happens? Oh, well, you know, don't go to the, we can't see at the hospital because you might die of COVID, but it's cool. You can go ahead and die of TB or some other disease. As long as you don't die of COVID. Yeah, that's real freaking humane. So there's just so much hypocrisy and corruption. in that one thing, COVID. I don't know how people can ever trust public health institutions again, or whether it be local, state, or federal government, depending on where you live, how you can trust these institutions anymore if they try to push this at us again.
Oh, yeah. It's the number of businesses that never recovered. I know there in the St. Louis area, there's hundreds of businesses that never reopened after COVID. Not to mention that once you got locked down, the only places that were allowed to operate were essential businesses. So you had some small like liquor stores and gas stations, but even gas stations, large corporations, Walmart, large corporation, Amazon, large corporation. It wasn't like you weren't allowed, like when you went to Target, you could shop through their clothes. You could shop through their electronics, but you couldn't go to Tom's electronics store. It's insane. It was there's so much to say about it. I could go on forever. Another thing is that corporations, are you saying that corporations it became greedy in May of 2020? No, corporations have always been greedy. What you did was gave them the tools on purpose to become more greedy, if anything. But also what people miss about inflation too is that if the dollars are inflated and you buy stocks with dollars, then the price of the stocks are going to go up with inflation. So if a company's posting record profits, it could be percentage-wise less than they were making year on year before, but the dollars are going to look like more because they're all inflated. And speaking of inflation, I was reading this thing by Tom Woods the other day. I think he's part of the Libertarian Institute. He had this thing written about the Federal Reserve and how the Federal Reserve, of course, causes inflation when they print money, when they print $6 trillion for COVID relief and $8 trillion for the Iraq war over 20 years, or not, for wars in the Middle East, I should say, over 20 years. Not only does the Fed printing money cause inflation, but when they print the money, they give it to their friends, they give it to contractors, and they give it to banks first before it's inflated. So they're spending the money while it's still at the value as when they printed it, but then everyone else after them catches the inflation. So by the time you get your raise and the dollar gets to you, the stuff up the street costs more. Like then up the street or at the grocery store, everything's already more expensive by the time the dollar comes to you. And so it's just a big scheme at this point.
Yeah. Channing George Carlin, it's a big club and you ain't in it. You know, it's that's basically it. And you're right. That's a point I've heard made several times by people who have more than two brain cells to rub together is when the stimulus money gets printed. Yeah. The people at the very top get it first. We get it second. And by the time it falls to us, yes, the currency is already devalued, not to mention the fact that they're going to print it and then you're going to get taxed on the money that they gave you. I love that, too. Well, here's some free money. Oh, by the way, we still need our cut of that. That's always a nice bonus they add in. And well, let's just get into it a little bit, Brandon, since we're already talking about them. Your thoughts on a Federal Reserve Bank or central banking just in general? What are your thoughts on systems like that?
I think if you look at the historical track record of central banking in America, it has only caused inflation. It has not prevented more bubbles, more economic bubbles. It has actually created more economic bubbles, more booms and busts. You have that with a fake system. It's a bunch of private banks controlled by the federal government manipulating the currency. So obviously it's a system set up for those at the top to keep winning and those at the bottom to continue to get the scraps. And like I said, if you look throughout all of history, because there were other federal banks, you know, and before the current system we have, and they were usually only built to fund wars, and then they would disband over time, because even the founding fathers knew that it wasn't strategically an advantage for the American people to have a central bank. It's terrible for the currency, it's terrible for the economy, and the only winners are the big institutions, not the people.
Yeah, you know, so just I've told the story so many times, but the friends of mine that they gave me the movie, the documentary, America, Freedom to Fascism, from Aaron Russo, and it was all about the federal income tax and the Federal Reserve. and that is the documentary that turned me, it made me do a 180 in the way I thought about politics, my government, everything. It completely changed my outlook on everything. And I was so blown away, you know, because there are still so many people that don't understand that the federal income tax that comes out of your check only goes to pay the interest that they charge to our government to print the money. People think it goes to pay for programs. It doesn't. They steal from you to pay a private entity to do their money printing. That should make everyone take pause and question everything they thought they knew. Because and that's what it did to me. It made me go, okay, if they're lying about this, they have to be lying to me about a whole bunch of other stuff. And then I just started reading books and watching stuff, and then sat there angry, so freaking mad, because I'm like, man, they taught this crap to me in school. I hear it on the news. My politicians are telling me this stuff. Everything they've told me is a lie. You know, okay, now what? What do we do? I have to ask, Brandon, because I want to start asking this question more to people who are running for, whether it's a local office, state, or federal office. How do we, in your opinion, how do we get people to take a step back and look, I don't care if they're Republican, Democrat, Libertarian, Green Party, look at the people that are running for office to see if they have a grasp on what government's role actually is, and get people to start thinking about natural rights, their natural rights stuff. You know, we got too many people that think their rights stem from government instead of their natural, enumerated in the Constitution. Let's say you approach somebody and you want to start up a conversation on some topic, Federal Reserve Bank, foreign policy, whatever, and somebody says, well, I think the government should, you know, has this. This is something in their purview. This is one of their responsibilities. What do you say to somebody when they think that government has the sole responsibility to take care of you or take care of this problem? Or how do you talk to people? Because this is a big problem. How do we communicate the message of liberty to people and get them to understand that the government we have right now is so bloated, so overreaching, and so corrupt, and that we could be a lot better off if they had they took on a much smaller role in our lives, where literally you don't even have to really interact with them. How do we get people to come to that realization?
I mean, I think it starts with knowledge of the Constitution first, because the federal government, as written in the Constitution, has limited powers. The founding fathers didn't write the Constitution because they were afraid of another government. They wrote the Constitution because they had just revolted against their own government and did not want to see tyranny take hold in America. And so I think the Interstate Commerce Act gets the Interstate Commerce portion of the Constitution gets misinterpreted a lot to just overstretch to every single thing. It's pretty state and plain that anything not directly mentioned in the federal Constitution is up to the states. And I think the smaller you make the government, people should want the government to be smaller so they can have more control over it. And I think it also has to do with the principle of liberty. I think if people reread the Declaration of Independence a couple times and read that you are guaranteed by your creator life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, then it shouldn't even be a question as to what liberties. You shouldn't want to step on someone else's liberties. You shouldn't want to tell the people in California how to raise their kids, and the people in California shouldn't be telling the people in Missouri how to raise their kids, what things they can and can't do inside of their own homes. So I think it's, you know, just going back to the, I think it starts in schools. I think what you need to do is there needs to be a, you know, not necessarily in schools, but at the education level, there needs to be a higher emphasis on the Constitution and less frivolous learning that happens, and more principles and things that people need to know, I would say.
Yeah, and you know, the other two, that the general welfare clause and the supremacy clause, are two things that the states and the feds So, you know about SEPA here in Missouri. I happened to, just by chance, interview. I saw the bill, and I had one of the bill sponsors on for like 15 minutes. Somebody chimed in the live chat and said, "What about automatic weapons?" You know, and he's like, "Well, because of the supremacy clause, that can't happen." And somebody immediately chimed in and said, "That's not what, you know, he's got that wrong." Now, still love SEPA, even though it's in the air right now. It's kind of floating around in the ether. We're not sure how or when the Supreme Court's going to hear this case. But those are the general welfare clause, you know, that got us the Affordable Care Act, because God forbid the Supreme Court could get that right. And then you have the supremacy clause. So there's another question. Have you really kept up with what Texas has been doing as far as trying to nationally divorce themselves from the union and just be their own country? Even if you're not familiar, what do you think about something like that? Because I tell a lot of people, a few years ago, if you would ask me that, I'd be like, man, that's dumb. But they have a great point. The federal government isn't looking out for that state. They don't care about their sovereignty with the problems they're having at the border. So let's become our own country. Then that border is definitely sovereign. We can handle our business, and we don't have to worry about some third party and their supposed supremacy over us. What do you think about something like, some people don't like the word secession, so I say national divorce. What are your thoughts on something like a national divorce?
Well, I definitely understand the sentiment. I feel like, I mean, the federal government is just so rampantly corrupt and out of control. The corporatist state has so taken over that I understand the people of Texas feel that the federal government is not looking out for them. I'm not going to say I either do or don't support it per se, but I definitely understand the sentiment about wanting the national divorce. I think within the federal constitution, like within the constitution, there's grounds with the way it was intended to be interpreted and the way it was written that Texas shouldn't have to do this. It's sad that it's came to this, is what I'll say. Is that it's came to the point where it's realistic and like understandable that a state would secede from the union. It shouldn't be that way. The federal government shouldn't have that much control over the people of Texas, and I don't think that's what the Constitution had in mind.
You know, just kind of circling back, boy, I sound like Biden's White House press secretary. I'm going to circle back to, or no, that was the former one. We're going to circle back, but I'm going to circle back to what you just said. And what we were talking about a minute ago is sovereignty, state sovereignty, and the Constitution. Well, I mean, what did our founders admonish us to do? You know, if you don't like your government, you change it or you get rid of it. They told us, you either change it or you abolish it or you alter it. But you don't sit back and think that voting for one person in the White House is going to change the course of history in the United States. I mean, yes, there could be a change in the course of history, but you're not going to alter the path of this country by electing one person, a specific person to the White House. I hate that people feel that way. Like, oh, yeah, he's just going to, because that means you're in a monarchy. You're treating that person like a king or a queen. But I have to ask you, Brandon, I guess the question would be, how important is it? Because I've heard Michael Rechtenwald speak on this in his debates or whatever, that he doesn't think he's going to just come into the White House and change everything. What he wants to do is get people locally focusing and building relationships and trying to fix it locally rather than depending on the federal government to resolve the issues. What do you take Rechtenwald out of the picture, but as far as local government versus your federal government, would you say that the local government was way more important to actually focus on to fix rather than the federal government?
I don't believe so. I could understand where people do, and I trust me, there's definitely my qualms with state and local government. I don't think, I mean, you know, even down to homeowners associations. But I will say that your state legislators are not the reason your trillion are not the reason that our country's trillions of dollars in debt. It wasn't your local legislators' decisions to lock down the country in 2020. It was the federal government's. Like, the biggest issues in our country right now stem from the federal government. And if your thought process is start local, win some city council races that aren't even necessarily political party affiliated, and then you're trying to slowly through the bottom ranks work up to defeat this, you know, these giant entities, you know, the biggest political shifters of my time in particular have been Donald Trump, who did no politics at all and then became the president, and then AOC on the Democrat side. She was this unknown bartender from New York who took on the establishment, and she won because her message was that these guys are corrupt. That was what Trump's whole message was, is that drain the swamp. Whether you think he successfully did that or think he even would in a second term is up for debate. But the revolutions, they don't start from the ground up at like the local politicians level. They're made with waves by people who take a chance and make a stand against actual corruption. And like I said, there's plenty of corruption to go around at the state and local level. It's those guys who end up becoming national politicians half the time anyway. And so I'm not saying there's no corruption at the state or local level, but I'm saying that if you want to know why everything at the grocery store is so expensive, don't go to your state house and expect to find the answer.
No, that is the problem, is that here in Missouri, half of our budget comes from the feds. Half of our $50+ billion budget comes from the federal government. Now, a lot of that is large in part because we have a lot of legislators here in the state who love free money, and that's got to change. I don't know how you change it. I don't know how you get federal or state legislators to stop taking federal money like it's going out of style, like there's no strings attached. I love how they pretend, it's free. Nothing that you get from the federal government is ever free. I don't care what they tell you. It's never free. It comes at a cost, and the cost is your liberty and freedom. The thing is, I would love to see more people on a local level organize and try to, or even on a state level, start nullifying bad federal laws, unconstitutional laws. I think that could go a long way if states would take back the power that the founders gave them, that's enumerated in the Constitution, to nullify. We have the 10th Amendment for a reason. Can we start nullifying bad federal laws? Because at some point, you can literally take away some of the federal government's control. Because if you choose not to enforce bad laws, you're forcing a group, some bureaucracy in D.C. to come enforce them, and they don't have enough people. So let's put the pressure on the feds. Okay, you want to enforce this law? Fine, enforce it. We're not going to do it for you anymore. I would love to see... And this is one of my other listeners came up with this idea, and I love it, to have a nullification caucus in Jefferson City. And they're going to look at federal laws, and they're going to say, which one can we nullify? Which regulatory agency and some of the rules can we nullify by passing legislation in the state? I would love to see that personally.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And like I said, there's definitely I've read a lot about the, you know, since the Mises Caucus came in, one of their big plays was from, you know, start local. And like I understand that concept, but I just don't know how much time we have either. You know, if we don't start getting the message out for not even necessarily libertarians, but for even like some of my favorite congressmen are Thomas Massey, Rand Paul. You can get support out for guys like that, and even within the Republican Party to generate support for just candidates that aren't going to spend all of your money, just anyone who's not going to spend your money. That's why I'm in this race, is because I'm certain that I'm one of the only people I'm the only person in my race who's not going to spend all of your money. I'm not going to send more money overseas. I'm not going to send any more money to any federal programs. I'm not going to vote yay on anything that's going to take any more tax dollars from Americans. And so I understand the concept, but I think this fight needs to be fought on a national level. I think it also involves around people, more people rallying for, like, in particular, the Libertarian candidate for president, whoever it is. I think it's going to take a lot of Libertarians rallying around that person, not just their own campaigns and their own pushes and their own agendas. You can't sit on the couch and expect liberty to happen for you. You've got to go fight for it. And so I also think it's going to take people fighting on the national level, too.
No, I couldn't agree more. Brandon, we've got about 2.5 minutes before I have to clip for a radio station, and we can proceed. So with about 2 minutes left for the Lake of the Ozarks area, give us a short pitch on your campaign. Everybody else will hear this, too. But with about 2 minutes left, give us a short pitch for your campaign, and then after I clip, we'll move on to some other conversation.
I think I'm the only candidate in this race who's actually only going to be beholden to two things, the Constitution and the people of Missouri's 2nd Congressional District. If you look at the incumbent right now, Ann Wagner, she is the opposite. She collects millions of dollars from donors. She voted against needing warrants for FISA 702 earlier today. She's voted to extend FISA 702 in the past. She's funded by BlackRock. She's funded by Pfizer. She's funded by the military industrial complex. You can look that up on opensecrets.org. And she has a super PAC in her name that funds that collects money from all kinds of dirty money interests. And I think if you want to get your liberty back, if you want someone who's going to fight for your values and Missouri values and not the values of DC, then vote for Brandon Daugherty for Missouri District 2.
And do you have a website or anything people can go, could go see?
I do. It is Daugherty, Daugherty, the number 4congress.com. And if you like my message and you can please donate to this campaign. It is extremely hard to run a grassroots campaign with no money. I'm fighting for money for like flyers and door hangers right now. So anything you can do to help me out would be great.
All right. For those of you in the KEYK audience, thank you so much for joining me again this week. If you like what you heard, again, go to Daugherty4Missouri.com. Next week, I don't have a guest slated as of yet, but again, the 26th, I'm looking forward to having Dr. Michael Rechtenwald on to talk about why he's running for president. I think you're going to like his message and his story in general. Again, for those of you in the KEYK audience, make sure you also check out molibertyradio.us. and some of their programmings, and on Sunday nights from 6 to 9 p.m. Central Time, Sam and Trish Britton, Off the Cuff Radio. We'll see you next week. All right, moving on, Brandon. Well, let me ask you this, because I've just been kind of jumping through the topics. Is there some topic or something in general that you're really passionate about as far as something that our government does, encroachments, you know, overreaching, whatever. Is there a certain topic that really kind of grabbed you when you moved from, let's say, more of a liberal type to a libertarian? Was there something that really grabbed your attention and said, man, this is really messed up?
We already kind of touched on what the main reason I'm running is America's abysmal foreign policy. I think if one of my inspirations is Scott Horton at antiwar.com, the founder of antiwar.com, and his book, Enough Already, Time to End the War on Terrorism. That is one of the biggest inspirations that made me want to run for office. You can take my money and try to do good things with it, and that's going to annoy me. It's going to annoy me to no end, and it's not liberty. But when you take my money and turn it into bombs and then bomb innocent people with it, I cannot in good conscience allow that to happen and not make a stand for it. It's why I started getting involved in my local LP, and it's why I'm running for this office, is because I can't fathom how people can justify taking, like, using your money, like our money, to hurt innocent people. And it's not that it's like a one-off that has happened occasionally. Like I said, in Scott Horton's book, he documents that in almost every single country that we assisted in the Middle East turned to just absolute chaos, from Iraq, Afghanistan, Libya, Syria, Somalia, Yemen, I mean, it even extended for after Libya. This problem extended all the way through Africa. If people look up America's African, AFRICOM is what it's called. It's like their joint venture of military endeavors in Africa. There's so many now that are fighting jihadists that weren't there, you know, 20, 30 years ago, that weren't like these issues that we're having now were not prevalent because these are people who we funded their side. Then we funded the other side. So they fled somewhere else and they became terrorists in a different country. It happened. It happened so many times. We have funded we funded Al-Qaeda knowingly four different times after 9/11. That was what blew my mind. So they became, we funded them in Libya, knowing that they were Al-Qaeda. And then they overthrew the Gaddafi government, which is still, which is a basically a train wreck of a nation right now that has human trafficking, like you were mentioning. You can, they're for $300, you could buy a person in Libya as not very long ago. And then those people, so after that, we actually, the CIA paid for them to go to Syria. Where then we funded al-Nusra, and we knew it was al-Nusra because there were reports that we were funding al-Qaeda and they had changed their name to al-Nusra. So we're funding them in Syria to fight Bashar al-Assad's government, and then they turned into ISIS. So we created ISIS. And then at the same time, while these moderate rebels, which turned out to be ISIS, we were fighting them in against Bashar al-Assad's government in Syria, we were also the CIA... It was either the CIA or the Defense Department. One of them was funding the Kurds, the Kurdish people who live in the Turkey, Iran, Iraq area in Syria. And there was a CIA group fighting a Department of Defense group. We were funding two sides of the same war. This was a big article that was in the LA Times right when it was happening. And it's things like that. It's that the our elected officials have gotten nothing right on foreign policy. Nothing. And it's insane that people, they still get elected to vote because it's one of the most, if not the most consequential thing. Like, obviously, if you print money at a fake virus, that's going to affect the economy a lot. But before COVID, the number one train wreck of the economy was for sure, without a doubt, military spending. And not even necessarily I am actually wouldn't want to see our military go away, of course. But what I would do, what I would advocate for is a withdrawal of as many troops, if not all troops, from overseas, and then cut down on certain department spending and booster more of an R&D approach where we want to be able to intercept missiles coming in, but you don't have to spend trillions of dollars to do that. It's a misnomer to think that you have to spend trillions of dollars to keep a strong military. That's not true. You could keep a strong military for about $200 billion a year. It's the $800 billion we spend sending them all over the world, not to mention for any of the leftists who are considering, you know, who are fed up with what's going on in Gaza right now. The military is also the number one polluter in America. They're the number one carbon emitter in the country is our military. So if you want to cut down on carbon emissions, why don't you cut down on sending all of these worst planes and ships in the seas all over and bring them back home to protect our homeland like they're supposed to?
Yeah, I have to get a hold of that book right now. I'm going through Tom Woods's Diary of a Psychosis. I'm trying to get through it. I'm getting closer to the end of it. I've been listening the last few days and actually tomorrow I'm driving to Springfield to hang out with our very own Tom Martz because Chris Ann Hall, William Federer, and Robert Brown are going to be down there to do a big constitutional conference. So Tom and I are going to hang out there tomorrow. But once I get through Tom's book, then I'm going to have to move on to some Scott Horton stuff. I haven't read any of his books yet. I do listen to his interviews podcast that he puts out. And he's got all these great guests. I envy the guy so much because he's just like an there's just like an encyclopedia in his head. He can just rattle his stuff off. And I'm like, my old man brain does not operate that way. And it drives me mad. It just drives me so batty because I'm like, how the heck is this? I go, that's his thing. That's what he does. But I really admire the guy because you know, it's hard. You can't debate the guy. If you're a neocon, you're going to lose because he's got more facts than you do. He's researched it more than the people who are pushing these wars. and knows probably more of the stuff than they do. So he's just going to mentally dominate them from the get-go. And it's just a beautiful thing. I had some other topics. Oh, let me ask you about this one. Let's say a bill came onto the House floor that said, which Thomas Massey writes like once a year, to end the Department of Education. What would your thoughts be on ending the Department of Education?
Absolutely. I am 100% for ending the Department of Education. I think, like I said, it's not something that the federal government should be involved in. It's a state's, like, the education should be a statewide entity. Personally, I am an expecting father, actually. I have no plans of sending my kid to any sort of public or private education. Not in the near future, at least. I haven't seen anything that, the public education, like on the federal level, the only thing that happens when you have these major entities is you have people like Randy Weingarten who take control of the teachers' unions, and then they decide that they're just not going to teach anymore. And they decide that until every kid and every parent and every teacher is vaccinated, that they're not going to reopen the schools and kids are failing and not learning anything. I think having that money, the billions of dollars that we spend, it shouldn't go away. It would go back to the parents, or you could put it into the state legislature. As far as I know right now, only 9% of funding for schools comes from the federal government in the first place. Most of it comes from the state and local level through property taxes. A very small percentage of it even comes from the federal government anyway. And so I think it's ridiculous on its face to think that the federal government should have a say in what your kid's education is, and why you would want that would be insane to me.
Yeah, because I know there's a big, Missouri right now has an issue with DESE, the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. And people, and I don't blame them, they want to see teachers' salaries increase. And I give people the option. Okay, DESE has close to 2,000 employees. That's just for education in the state of Missouri. And there's a whole lot of government agencies that are understaffed. Cut them from DESE, move them somewhere else, take that money, and give the teachers a raise. So you've shrunk DESE, and you've increased teacher wages. You've just killed two birds with one stone. But nobody wants to do that. They want to up the education budget. They want to create more roles in DESE. They want DESE's umbrella to get bigger. And that comes from both parties. Both parties want to control DESE so bad. But they both end up, this Senate Bill 727, that's supposed to be about, school choice. There's dangerous language in that bill that seems like it's wanting to move homeschoolers and recategorize them. But in there is a thing about firearms in schools. Well, if you take homeschoolers and move them under a different umbrella, and then that means, even though there's all these lobbyists like, oh, no, we're not going to try to take homeschoolers' guns from them, there are lawyers that have looked at the bill language and said, au contraire, mon frere, it looks like they could do that. But the so-called freedom guys are pushing SB 727. Lobbyists are threatening. I guess the lobbyists are pulling out the whips and cracking them, and they're just trying to shove it through. And just like, fine, shrink DESE. No, but that doesn't seem to fit inside the box in either party for the most part. Some of them want to actually shrink DESE, but a lot of them, they just want to control DESE more. And I would just think that even at a state level, we could break that down and give the local areas more control over education and take some of the powers away at the state level. Same way at the feds. Take away the federal, give it to the state, and then the state breaks it down and we get more local with education, because people should have the choice. If you're going to steal people's money because they own property, the least you can do is give them more control over the education that their children receive with the money that's stolen from them.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. 100%. And I, if you look at the studies around it, it's education, like in schooling, only goes so far. It's education that you get at home that they really is going to bolster a lot of it, too. So, you're trying, I think, if you want to see education scores get higher, what you're going to want to do is put more money back into Americans' pockets so they have more opportunities for their kids. I think the like education, if you look at where it's failing, especially in the state of Missouri, there it's not a question as to it's an income area. It's income areas that directly affect education. And so it's not necessarily, and you can look at also studies where pumping money into a school does not make it a better school. Have you ever seen, I'm pretty sure that the LeBron James school, the school he built, the My Promise school.
I haven't I heard about it, but I haven't like seen any like real information on it.
Well, I read a thing came out not very long ago that like every single one of those kids couldn't read at whatever level they were supposed to read. Or it was the math, one of their scores, that not a single kid at the school hit the level. And so it almost goes to show you that you can pump a bunch of money at an issue and it's not necessarily going to fix it. You know, if you just give money to something with no structure, it's not going to help.
Well, yeah, there's a lot of bad information out there, especially coming from the left, that they want to defund education in the state of Missouri. Well, they can't. Part of the Constitution says that a quarter of the state's budget goes directly to education. So every time the budget goes up, which it keeps increasing, the Department of DESE education gets more money. And they're trying to defund education. And I have to keep getting on Twitter and saying, you can't do that. They literally cannot do it. Unless they shrink the budget, they cannot defund education. It's tied in the Missouri Constitution. It's tied in the statute. Now, why somebody would do that, I don't freaking know. That's a dangerous way to go about things. Again, because if you look at any government institution, well, let's just face it. How many things has our government declared war on? And all those have gotten worse. The war on poverty, the war on drugs, the war on illiteracy, all these things that government declares war on, those problems don't get resolved. They exponentially get worse. And try again, another challenge to get people to understand is that if the government decides they want to declare war on something, the first word out of your mouth should be no. Just no. I don't even have to explain myself. I shouldn't even have to explain myself. I should just be able to open up a history book or whatever, or go online and look at the stats and go, Your Honor, I give you exhibits A through Z, why we don't want government to declare war on this. Everything gets so much worse. And then, of course, like you said, with education, they keep throwing more money at it. They create a new government agency to look into the problem. They create another middleman, and you lost more liberty. You lost more of your money. It's just, let's stop declaring war on things for a while. Let's just take it easy.
Well, another big problem they have is when they try to add money to things, they use DEI systems. Like, anything DEI-related, I don't want to name any names or any schools, but there was a school in Missouri where a friend of mine's kid went to school and came home from school one day, and their teacher told them that it was okay for boys to wear dresses, and that if he wanted to wear a dress, that was totally fine. And that, it's just one of those things where I'm like, this is what happens when you keep trying to pump money at a problem instead of finding the root causes of a problem. Is let's give more money to these schools. Well, what are they going to go do? They're going to go make a diversity and equity hire, an inclusion hire. And then that person's going to come in and try to tell your kid it's okay to wear a dress. If you want your kid to wear a dress, I'm a libertarian. I don't care. But don't try to make other kids, Actually, I shouldn't even say that, because that's going to go down a dark road, and I don't necessarily support, you know.
No, I know what you're saying. If a child chooses that, it seems hinky to me, but okay. But once you fund some idiot at some school to try to brainwash your kids into thinking that's normal, there's the problem. You're stealing my money. And then your thing is, how do I want to educate kids? I should just educate boys that it's okay to wear a dress. No. How about some reading, writing, and arithmetic, for God's sakes? I mean, not to mention the fact, I mentioned this last week, you know, our kids are taught to score good on standardized testing. That's not education. That's training kids to be good little boys and girls so the school keeps getting their money and maybe even more money. But that's not education. That's propagandizing them. And that's just, you can't expect kids to go out and succeed if you're just trying to get them to a certain level. Can't think outside the box, can't do any of these things. If you just do good enough to pass the standardized test, we give you a little piece of paper, and then we just think that they're just going to go out and be all these awesome, productive members of society. They're going to go to a university, they're going to get their heads pumped full of more junk, and then we want, you know, how do we as liberty lovers expect those people to come to an understanding that these rights you have are natural? They don't come from government. You are a sovereign individual. You shouldn't be taxed at the rate. You shouldn't be dropping palms on people you probably can't even find on a globe. This is how we got to where we're at now. And there's so many problems that are compounded by federal funding. It you sit back and you think, how do we begin to fight this? What's the first step in fighting this bad thing, this stinking thinking, as my friends calls it? How do you even get to where you drive home the point to people that the rights of the individual override everything else? And it's such a horrible problem because it's a multi-front war that we have to fight to get our liberty back. And there's no easy answer as to where do we start fighting back at.
If I had to pick a place to start the fight, it would be the media. Because I think that the news and the media, what people don't understand is that the news is not there to tell you the truth. The news is there to sell to advertisers. And how do they sell to advertisers? By selling fear. And if they can do both at the same time, even better. So when they got you scared of COVID, when the local news made you afraid of COVID, so you would turn on the news the next day and watch them, and then you would see their advertisements for all of these different pharmaceutical drugs, that's where they're getting their money from. They don't get their money from telling the truth, and they haven't for a very long time. And it's not just necessarily like, what I love to see is people who are like, oh, I'd never watch MSNBC. Oh, I would never watch Fox. Could never watch Fox News. But their local affiliate, I could never get enough of. It's like those are the same people who own that. They're controlling the information. They control the narrative. And so if you want to fight back, it's got to be supporting people like you and your show and people, other people who do podcasts. It's people at home who just, for the scrollers. There's like a whole mass of people out there who they believe what we believe in, but all they'll do is sit there and fight on their phone. And if you're going to do that, then at least be sharing other people's stuff, at least be retweeting and reposting other liberty-minded things, and fight back against the narrative and speak truth to power where you can. But I think, and what's great about X, and I wanted to say YouTube for a long time, but now not YouTube anymore because they started censoring everybody. But I think that a lot of I think the biggest thing is tackling the media. Is if you can just convince enough people that the news is not worth watching and that they need to find their news from independent sources who, and I think it also people need to hold their journalists to a higher standard. You know, they'll catch people lying on the news all the time and they'll come back right on the news like a week later lying to you again. And it's because the people watching, like especially on the left, in my opinion, they have no standards for the truth anymore. Does it fit their narrative? Yes or no? It's in or out. It has nothing to do with the truth.
Yeah, you know, you talk about that in that book from Tom Woods, where in Britain, one person came out and said, yeah, the government told us to frame the narrative on COVID a certain way so they didn't look bad. Everything they were doing was right. The lockdowns, the passports, the mandates, everything was right on cue with the way you're supposed to treat a pandemic. They were told from the get-go, you have to frame us in a good light. You know that happened over here. And again, when your sponsors are Pfizer and Moderna and Johnson & Johnson, you're not going to get unbiased media details on actual cases, death rates, all that. You're not going to get, as Fox News would like to proclaim, fair and balanced. You're not getting that because that doesn't fit the interests of the advertisers.
Exactly. Oh, just side note really quick.
Sure.
I love how the Diary of Psychosis is like it was all of his old journal entries. And so you get to just it's play by play. You know, sometimes whenever people write books about things like this, it misses a lot of important details. But he's got them all in order. Yeah, I'm on page about 80 right now. It's really good.
I'm at 200 and something right now, because every chapter is the next one, the next day or whatever of his email list. And I've been a subscriber of his email list for a few years now, and he's just one of those guys. That's another guy that I look up to. I mean, that what he's built on his podcast alone and his email list and everything. The guy just knocks it out of the park. And he's got so many great guests. Because I wasn't sure how he was going to frame that book. I heard him talk about it a little bit. And then I got it as an Audible. I got it from Audible so I could just listen on the way back and forth because I have an hour commute to and from work. So it was perfect for me. And it was, when I found out it was just his email list, I'm like, this is the diary. The word diary finally kicked in. Like, oh, okay, like a daily diary entry of what was going on. It is just, to me, it's just about perfectly done. And
done.
What's even better about the audio version, it's Tom Woods reading it. So that's like a bonus. But as he's reading some of them, it brought back to me, oh, man, I remember reading that. In one of the daily emails, I remember that email that he sent out because I was doing a show. I was talking about it a lot, but there were weeks I'm like, I have to take a break away from COVID because it was driving me absolutely bonkers because it seemed like all I was talking about, trying to get businesses around here to understand you don't have. Yeah, I know you're normally competitive, but since the health department's picking on people, how about you band together and tell the health departments, we're not working at a certain capacity and we're not shutting down. We're all going to band together and you're going to have to force us to shut down. But instead, one business would disregard the rules and the other businesses are like, he's not following the rules. What are you doing? You're literally taking the shackles and tightening them up. You know, grow a spine and stand up with a guy and say, hey, I know we're normally competitors, but we're gonna just have a truce here and we're all going to fight back against these, appointed people who don't understand how badly they're wrecking the economy. We're going to stand up for what's right. We're going to operate as if there's no pandemic whatsoever. That's all I wanted. And it just, I didn't see much of it. It was disappointing.
Even back then, I was definitely – I considered myself a conservative. But I can't lie. I fell for everything COVID-related for, the first 3 months. I really did. Everything that they would come out on the news and say, they're like, oh, this has got to do this, you got to do that. I'm not going to lie. I fell for it. So going back and rereading it and being able to, up until about June, I will say I was really early – for people who were duped by everyone to catch on by, because I, even months before the vaccine came out, I was telling everybody, I'm never taking that vaccine. I actually worked in St. Louis County where they were threatening to make everybody get the vaccine to work. That was a rumor that had been swirling around for forever. And I told everybody, I was like, you're never going to get me to take a vaccine super early on. But even so, it's interesting in that book being able to go back and see the contradictions even as early as May of 2020, whenever Florida reopened and everyone was like, DeSantis is going to kill everyone in Florida. And then it didn't happen. And so,
And then they
would write articles. My favorite one is the article where this one lady was like, will Ron DeSantis ever pay for endangering Floridians? And it was one of those big name newspapers, I can't remember which one, but one of the big ones was posting that stuff. And it was just crazy. It's crazy to me.
Well, I'll tell you, Brandon, the reason when they first started bringing it out and started talking about it, when Nancy Pelosi called it an invisible enemy, like within the first couple weeks, I'm like, nope. As soon as that woman, as soon as those words started coming out of their mouth, I have enough distrust in my government where I was like, I can't. And now, here's what I did. Like, we go to Walmart here in town, and they would hand us the mask. I would not berate the person that was hired to hand out the mask. I would say thank you, I would stick it in my pocket, and I would continue walking on. Now, what my wife and I decided to do was, which we generally do anyway, we give everybody their space, we would follow the arrows up and down the aisles, we would make sure we stayed out of everybody's way, just to be a civilized adult, and that's what we did. We were doing that, and then we were seeing people, not that it really matters, but in the grand scheme of things, it really irritated us. They were walking the wrong way up the aisle, wearing a mask, and they had a face shield on, and gloves, yeah. And they were going up the wrong way, right down the middle of the aisle, so you couldn't get around them. And my wife goes, I can't say exactly what she said, because got to make it radio-friendly, but she's like, screw this, we're going to walk whichever direction we want to. She's like, I wanted to be civilized, I tried to, you know, play nice, and she goes, now we have this. She's like, screw it, we're going to walk whichever way we want to walk. I was like, that's cool with me, I'm fine. If somebody stopped to grab something off the shelf, just so I didn't have to listen to it, you're in my personal space or whatever, I would stay a few feet back from them. But I try to do that anyway. I try not to just get right up against people in the store. That's just, I like right. My personal space. That's what we did. It worked great for us. I got COVID when it was like the Delta variant or whatever. It was like I had strep throat for like 2 or 3 days. That's all I got out of it. And here's the thing, Brandon. This is what got me. I thought I had strep. I go to the doctor, and first thing to do, of course, swab my nose. And she's like, okay, you got COVID. And I go, and? She's like, well, you got COVID. I go, okay. So I'm going to go ahead and uptake my vitamin D, vitamin C, and zinc. She goes, yeah, that won't do anything. Oh, dude, I almost lost my you-know-what in the doctor's office. I didn't say anything. We got out of the doctor. I told my wife, I was like, we're going to the store. Go in there and get me these three things, and I'm going to take them every day. Because I had two other work friends that their doctors were telling them, take this amount of vitamin D, this amount of vitamin C, and this amount of zinc, and this will help boost your immune system and help you kick it sooner. And she's saying, yeah. So I want to look at her and go, okay, you're a doctor, and you're telling me that minerals and vitamins won't do me any good. Where did you get your medical degree? Where'd you get your license to practice? From a Cracker Jack box? What are we doing here?
You bring up another good point with that, too, that I forgot to mention earlier when you asked me about the COVID, is that they were intentionally keeping people from taking ivermectin and hydrochloroquine, which were helpful. They were burying studies proving that those, like even the CNN, then they were trying to say that Joe Rogan was on horse dewormer. And that's insane because what they should have done whenever he got COVID and then was symptom free, testing negative 2 days later, they should have got a pen and paper out and been like, okay, what was everything you did? We're going to study that. No, they were like, I'm surprised he's still alive. They went full establishment on him. And it's insane because there are people who, you know, how much science you really believe? Because again, once you start, now it's hard to tell what's real and what's not. That's the worst part, is now you can't differentiate between who's dying from COVID, who's dying with COVID, how much of an effect it actually has on someone who's not 85 with a lung disease. And so these treatments definitely could have saved lives. I mean, at least not made people less sick, but it could have saved lives being able to take ivermectin and hydrochloroquine. You know, if it would have saved lives, and it's crazy that it got buried for the gain of a vaccine that didn't keep you from getting sick.
Yeah, that's the best part. And you know, that's one thing. When they were talking about the boosters, and then what was his name? One of the guys that signed the Great Barrington Declaration. He's like, you know, he got on Twitter, he's like, you realize that vaccine was only tested on 8 mice and no humans, right? 8 mice. You can't even get a good study from 8 mice. They're like, this should block the variant. You shouldn't get it. And it's like,
I didn't hear that.
Eight mice. So you haven't got far enough in the book. Once you get farther in the book, he'll talk about that. Wow. I think it was Bhattacharya said that. I think it was Dr. Bhattacharya's like, they tested on 8 mice. That's it. And in England or Europe, there was a lot of Europe that they banned the Moderna vaccine. So it's just a whole thing. It's screwed up because there's so many people that have just want to pretend that that never happened. And it, to me, that's the worst thing you could possibly ever do is to pretend that we did not just suffer through 2.5 years of complete and total tyranny by people who would just lie to you when the truth would serve them best, and people just want to act like it never happened. I don't want to be one of those people. I still bring this subject up all the time because I don't ever... You're going to be a father, Brandon, and I just got my first grandkid last week, so I don't want my granddaughter growing up through that kind of rubbish ever again. What we suffered through, I don't want my grandkids ever having to deal with a bunch of unelected or elected bureaucrats ruining an economy and driving people to deaths of despair because they have an agenda. I don't want to ever live through that ever again.
I have a question for you. Okay. Do you think that they're going to... Do you think that they are going to try to do some heavy mail-in voting in Pennsylvania again this year? With the bird flu. Or it might not even be this avian bird flu, but do you think they're going to try to... Like, not even necessarily everywhere. Because you would have to be a real idiot to think you're going to get away with locking anyone in Missouri down again. But there's areas that you can lock down to secure this election. So, like, let me put my conspiracy theory hat on for a second. I could see, like, them doing mail-in voting in a lot of these big cities, even in Republican states, but just big cities, because that's all they need. And then they could wheel the ballots in the middle of the night because their area is guarded by Democrats, being counted by Democrats. And so they could just wheel in ballots or even just get ballot harvest enough signatures in these big cities to win. Do you think they're going to try it again, or do you think they're...
I'll give it from my perspective. I don't think that's going to happen this time. I think what they're going to do is because of the... millions of illegals they've just let walk across the border and say, I think those people are going to be the voters this time. I think that's how they're going to get the votes. I think it's going to be because we know certain states, New York, California, some of these, they'd love to do it. They'd love to say, here's your driver's license. Here's all these. You get to act like a U.S. citizen, even though you're not naturalized or anything else. And they're going to let them vote. And I think... we got to see a total capture of our election system because of these voting machines and everything else. And I would love it. One push I would like to see in a lot of states, even if it's just Republican states, is we're doing paper ballots and they're hand counted. I don't care that it takes an extra 3 or 4 days to get the vote totals in. This instant gratification crap has spread into the election system. So we have to have this centralized computer system feeding ballots into machines that, what was it, Hacking Democracy, that documentary that I watched years ago. The woman saying Republican and Democrats were doing well because they showed a machine. The guy touched the name of the person he wanted to vote for, and it gave a tally to the other person, okay? God, and they're saying in states, Republicans and Democrats both benefited from these faulty machines. And I think that if we want to get back to actual maybe elections that you can actually sort of trust, if we don't go back to paper ballots and hand counting, I think we're ripe for the taking. And I think we've got a lot of outside influence, outside the U.S. influence on our elections. I think this government is bought and paid for. and they're not going to want to change it because depending on which way the pendulum's swinging, left or right, it's going to benefit one party or the other party. I don't think, in actuality, either party at the leadership level wants to fix the elections because it could benefit them one day down the road if the right person is running, or, you know, the selected person is running for that office and they want to get him in because he's going to get us all these things. I don't think either party is super serious about fixing this. I think it's a good divisive drive a wedge issue between people to get them fighting so you're not paying attention how badly you've been getting screwed over by your own federal government, sometimes state governments, for years upon years. And I just don't think, unless we have states that get serious and say, paper ballot only, and the feds can throw a fit, but the states are allowed to make their own election laws. I think if we don't get away from machine tabulation, we are screwed.
I agree with that 100%. Yeah, I think it didn't even process that they're going to try to get all of these immigrants to vote. I knew that they were doing that. Matt Gaetz got in trouble for saying it out the, I can't remember what it's called, what the Democrats call it. But yeah, where they bring in immigrants to change the voting block. Yeah, I didn't even, wow.
You know, that's the thing. I don't care. This YouTube video is going to get a strike. we've been talking about so many taboo subjects tonight that they're going to be like, yep, that one's strike.
Despite everything we've said, the vaccine is safe and effective. Let's know
yeah,
that.
I got my sixth booster yesterday. Absolutely. That's the thing. That's my problem, Brandon. I've come to consider DC a dumpster fire, and I've kind of given up because of the duopoly. They don't seem serious. I know I'm painting with a broad brush, but really, like 90-95% of them don't seem serious about really resolving the issues. Actually getting out of the way. And I can't remember the name of the show. What was the name of the network? But they had this little bumper they would play. It would say, there are those who just want to be left alone and those who just won't leave them alone. Which one are you? I love that saying. It's perfect. And this world, this government is filled with people who just won't leave us alone. I got to ask you this. When you look at society today, because a lot of people want to turn to government for a solution, but do you still think there are a lot of people out there, no matter what party they belong to, at the end of the day, they just really want to be left alone? They really don't want to be bothered? Do you think there's still a lot of people out there that feel that way?
Oh, man, I hope so. I mean, I do for sure. And that's what I mean. Like, now that you ponder it that way, like, I just assumed everyone does. But, you know, a lot of people vote Democrat, so it's hard to say. Again, you know, I rail on Democrats a lot because the ones at the federal level, the ones at the top are the most corrupt people on the planet. And so, like, you know, Joe Biden and them, but like I said, my family grew up Democrat. I understand. I have family members still to this day that are Democrat, but, I don't think the Democrats care to be left alone the way Republicans do. Like, I actually think Republicans are slowly becoming more, on certain issues, leaving people alone. Social issues. I think they're slowly starting to come along but not nearly fast enough, in my opinion. And I think that's why they lose elections sometimes, is because they don't see the forest for the trees, or whatever the phrase is. Yeah.
Yeah. No. You got it. You got it right. I agree. There. I know that just in Missouri alone, there are an awful lot of people who are coming to grips with just how corrupt even people in the Republican Party are. People at leadership in Jefferson City, how corrupt they are. If you do just a little bit of digging, you're going to see it. And if it's that bad at the state level, you can imagine what it's like at the federal level. The problem is they still seem to act like they're in a cult sometimes. They think they have to vote for a Republican. I have beat up on the Libertarian Party, especially here in Missouri. During COVID, I was incensed with those people because I believe at that time the Libertarians had the biggest opening to show people what small government looked like by getting out in front of the COVID thing and saying, all this stuff that's going on is not right. And there was a lot of silence until about 2 years into it where they seemed to get the cojones to come out and talk about it. But we have a problem in this state where people just seem to be enamored with rhinos and they keep voting them into office because it's at least it's not a Democrat. And so, yeah, we can blame it on politicians all day long. But, you know, when it's all said and done, it comes back to the people. Why are you voting for these rhinos? Why are you not looking for people who understand who know what government's role is, who knows what their responsibilities are to defend and uphold the Constitution of the state and the federal government? And anything that goes against the Constitution is an automatic no. These omnibus bills that we pass, even in the state, they're unconstitutional. If the title and the language have to match up, and if you're writing a bill and you need like Parson and these tax credits for just agricultural, no, that's unconstitutional. It says in there everyone is supposed to be equally, you know, covered under this, whatever it is. And if you're picking out certain groups of people for a tax credit, then you're violating the Constitution. We have to find a whole lot of people, whether it's in this state or at the federal level, that understand that. But again, like you said, between the media and what we're talking about earlier in education, that is a hell of a hill to climb to get people to snap out of this. You are a sovereign individual with natural rights, and those fools in Jeff City and Washington, D.C. are supposed to only protect those rights, not to grant or take away natural rights. They are there simply to defend them and to make sure that we don't get to where we're at right now with, you know, wannabe tyrants scattered throughout the joint. It's really disheartening. And again, that's why I said earlier, you got to really, when it comes down to it, you got to really pick your battles. You know, what do you think is the most important thing that you can do as an individual or a group of people? And we need so many groups fighting against so many fronts on this, in this war for liberty. I don't know how you just, at the end of the day, how do you filter this all out and figure out what you need to get done? Because, you know, we could get a really good bill. Like, let's say gold and silver gets done. There's a big push to make gold and silver legal money here in Missouri. We could get that done. But people tend to, once they get something like that done, they tend to put their blinders on. It's like, okay, you still have to pay attention to all these people that you worked with, because you might have got gold and silver as legal money, but then over here, you just got taxed again, or the taxes increased, or they took more federal money to throw into the budget that took more liberties away. It's like, you know, it's like when Donald Trump got elected, people just stop paying attention. Like, no, the guy can't solve it by himself. Even Ron Paul, let's say Ron Paul was 20 years younger and he was the front runner and he was a shoe-in to get elected. He's not going to go in there and fix everything that ails us. I would have liked that, because he would have, the focus would have been on Congress. He could have said, I'm doing things by the Constitution. They're screwing up. You need to pay attention to what Congress is doing. But right now we got this tennis match between the White House and Congress. And it's back and forth, this back and forth volley. And it's like, God, they're all screwed up. Pay attention to all of them. That, you know, the Congress wants to blame, you know, people in Congress want to blame the president. And then the president wants to blame Congress. And while people are watching this tennis match, the greedy people are going to the bank, and you're losing more of your prosperity, more of your peace, and more of your liberty. It's like, just pay attention a little bit, for the love of God.
Yes, it's insane. So like, I've been a little bit slow getting out there. I went to a gun show in St. Charles not too long ago, and then I was at the Mardi Gras party in Defiance, and I was campaigning at both of those places, and it's fascinating how many people don't know their U.S. representative. It's a shocking amount of people that I'm like, do you live in this area? And they're like, yes. And I'm like, do you know the name of your representative? And they go, no. And they're like, I know they're Republican. And I'm like, that doesn't matter as much as you think it does. Like, you think that stands for limited government, and that is not what that stands for anymore.
No, you're right.
So I think what you were saying is right, is that it's an people need to do their own research. Like, if you're angry at the way the country's being ran, but you don't know the name of the person who represents you in Congress, how mad are you? How mad are you?
And how are you able to, you know, take accountability for that? Again, when I got introduced to this information, I was mad at myself. I was mad at myself for believing all this stuff. And so it made me want to research and do a lot of reading to make sure that I didn't get fooled by it. And it took a while because there was a lot of stuff to filter through. But I've told because people are like, well, how do you know this is XYZ is going to happen? It's a vicious cycle. All you have to do anymore is read a newspaper article. You can see the way the language is written, and you know exactly what's coming, because there's no need for them to change their motives or the way they operate, because it still works. So once you learn the pattern, you can pick it out a mile away what they're going to do. You know exactly what they're going to do, because they've used the same method for decades, and enough people haven't woken up to the what they call the Hegelian dialectic. And so you're like, it's not that. Listen, I am not that smart. People are like, you're really smart on this. No, I'm not. There are way more people out there that know way more about this stuff. I know enough to be dangerous, and I know enough to pick out when I see an article and I see a representative or somebody saying something, then I know that it's a power grab. I know it's coming. They're gonna create this issue. They're gonna wait for the people to throw a fit, and they're gonna ask the government to save them. And the solution to the problem, or the solution, is going to be worse than the original problem that they created. It's not hard to map out. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure this out.
Oh yeah, I think what you said a second ago highlights the war industry more than anything. Their play for convincing the American people or trying to win public support for a war is the same every time. They make it seem like the other country has done some horrific humanitarian, like they're like, oh, Bashar al-Assad is killing his people. The Yemeni, the Houthis are killing their own people. The Libyan government, the Syrian government, the Iraqi government, Saddam Hussein's killing his own people. And they'd come up with fake stories that would be read. I mean, obviously, there are a lot of terrible Middle Eastern dictators, at least there have been throughout history. So I'm not saying that every single one was a good guy, but not every single incident is a reason to invade their country. And that there was several times where they would just make up stories. Like I said, in Scott Horton's book, he outlines it great. There's a bunch of instances where people just make up stories. Like United States officials and UN ambassadors and people who just make up stories about atrocities happening in certain countries. A big one was when Saddam Hussein was first invaded Kuwait in 2001, I want to say. Or maybe it was before then.
It was 91, actually.
What did I say?
Yeah.
91. So whenever Saddam Hussein went into Kuwait in 91, the people, I'm blanking on who it was, but somebody came up with a story that the Iraqi soldiers were killing babies. And so then immediately that just garnered American support. Like, that was like one of the big stories that like pushed it over the edge. And it turned out that, there was no evidence that that was true. And the person who retold that story to Congress was not even there. Like, it was some third-party tale that they'd made up, and they knew they'd made it up. It was a lie from the beginning to bolster support for the first Iraq war. And so, like you said, it's they have these plays where you can just see what's coming from a mile away. They want to get rid of a dictator or something. They do this. They run the same play, and the same people fall for it every time.
No, you're absolutely right. I think that's what disappoints me the most. It's not like they change their tactics all the time. It's common. They do what they have to do to get their support, and they're not changing anything they're doing at all. They're not changing it would be just like me if I was selling a product and I didn't have to change my advertising because it sold. Why would I change the packaging? Why would I change the advertising? I'm still outselling all my competitors. Why? Same thing with the government. They're selling you, of course, the product they're selling you is god awful, and you don't, you know, you shouldn't want to buy it, but they keep selling it and people keep buying it. Why change the advertising? Why change the way they propaganda? Now, mind you, it does suck because of the intertwining of the internet and government, the media and government. It has made them way more effective. Their reach is far greater than it used to be. You know, if you have tech companies willing to work with them to censor, well, yeah, they haven't changed tactics. It's just they brought more people on board. They have more foot soldiers to run the propaganda than they used to. So their reach has gotten greater, and we're just under a bigger umbrella of the propaganda machine. But the tactics really haven't changed. It's just they have more weapons at their disposal now. That's the worst part of it.
I think people, it's amazing to me. We touched on this earlier, but it's still, like you said, it amazes me the level of propaganda that Americans are willing to just put themselves through. The level of propaganda that they are willing to just take. Like, it's third world countries would be envious. Because at least in third world countries, they understand, like when you talk to people from other countries, they know their media is corrupt. It's not that much people that, like, either you think Fox is corrupt or you think MSNBC is corrupt for most people. There's the people who think both are corrupt, but there are a lot of people who think one or the other is corrupt. And it's funny to me how much they can get away with because of that.
Oh yeah, it is disturbing. Well, Brandon, good golly, we've gone almost 2 hours. I'm gonna have to cut this off pretty soon. I've loved our conversation. I can tell you, this is not to like pat myself on the back, but if this was 2 years ago and I was doing this interview, I've just gotten better as an interviewer, and I'm able to have conversations way better with people that I don't know at all, never met before. This has been a great conversation, and I am pleasantly surprised because I've interviewed so many candidates, and sometimes everything sounds canned, so I never know how someone's going to sound until the conversation starts. I've had people, this is a great freedom candidate, you need to interview him, and everything sounds like someone else wrote it for them, and I'm like, oh, come on. Like, okay, you know what? Screw it. We're going to go a little bit longer because there's one topic I didn't get into, but I'm going to bring it up because of what I'm saying. I was asking candidates about, before recreational marijuana was a thing, what their thoughts were on a drug war. Now, these freedom-loving Republican candidates all were like, I've seen the impact that drugs have had on people. Like, weed? Really? You think weed's, like, ruining lives? Like, I don't see that. But not to take up too much more time, but give me a rundown of your thoughts on the war on drugs, because we never touched on that, but I got to hit on it a little bit.
If we're talking about marijuana in particular, I think that's crazy that it's even still Schedule 1. That it's super frustrating, too, because you ask most of the people, like Missouri, passed it on a voter, on a ballot initiative. And so it's not like the people of Missouri were for it. And Missouri is one of the most conservative states in the country. And so that should have been a bell, you know, a bellwether for that, the fact that this shouldn't have been an issue in the first place. Plus, you can talk about like all of the war on drugs. I mean, we could go for hours on how that's negatively affected the people it's supposed to help the most. And I personally don't think it should be a criminal offense to be using drugs. I think if you're using hard drugs, jail is not very rarely does jail clean you out. And then you go, like, you get out of jail, they'll slap you on the wrist, and then you're back on the streets. I don't think we need government parks where you can go do heroin. I think that's insane. I think it's a social issue, though. It's just another thing that, like, the government can't help you fix a drug problem. You have to find a support group. It takes a lot. It's beating addiction is one of the hardest things. I mean, I know of several close friends who've battled really tough addictions and won and came out better on the other side for it. But it's, you need a support system. You need, you know, not everybody has this, but you need friends. You need people who care about you, and you need an opportunity to get clean somewhere safe. And I don't think the government can afford that. The government can't give you a loving support system. And that's what it takes to beat addiction. And you're locking people in jail for using the drug when all they're going to do is get out and use it again. So you've wasted government resources arresting them, a wasted government resources sending them to court, and then they're going to be out in the streets using it again. So what did we do? We just wasted a bunch of money.
Yeah, I think we got to treat drugs, as, you know, like you're saying, heroin, meth, things like that. We got to treat them as a medical issue and not a criminal issue. I think criminalizing people who have made bad choices, and it's victimless. There is no victim besides themselves. I think putting them in jail is only compounding the problem, because they're going to learn. You send these people to jail, you have a twofold issue. They're going to learn how to be a better criminal from other hardened criminals. And then people love to say, oh, people deserve a second chance. But a lot of employers see a drug record or some kind of drug offense on a record. They're not going to hire them. So you've made them unhirable. You've ruined their life, and by putting them in jail, and they didn't even get the medical help they need to maybe kick this addiction problem. So it's twofold. Again, the prohibition never works, ever. They proved it with alcohol. They're proving it with illicit drugs. It doesn't do any freaking good to put people in jail. And not when we're talking about this, you know, most of the time it's a victimless crime. They're the only victim, and they're the victim of their own actions. And that's just one of the things. The putting people in jail for doing a drug or for a crime where there is no victim, whether it's drugs or anything else. I God knows how many people can't get jobs because they, they made a bad choice, but no one else is harmed. And we got a lot of people out there that return to a life of crime because they can't get a job now, because our government has deemed these people horrible people and decided the only recourse is to come up with mandatory minimum sentences. So, oh, you were caught in possession of a certain plant and you were within 2,000 feet of a school, so you have to spend 20 years in prison. It's absolutely asinine. It's naive. It's stupid. And that's the problem with government. They want to come up with a solution, and they go way beyond the point of necessity. And yeah, they go into all these poor areas of the country, absolutely just got ruined. Cities got ruined. Not only because the CIA decided to bring in 2 to 4 tons of cocaine to fight off communists, so we ruin millions of black or minority lives because we're like, hey, yeah, why not? Let's bring in the drugs to fight communism, and then we'll turn around at the people that sold us that made the money to get back to the big boys to help us fight the Sandinistas. Yeah, we'll toss them on in jail on the problem that we created. The government, well, not we, the government created.
Yeah.
So why would you trust them? Of course, a lot of people don't want to believe that the CIA, you know, smuggled in up to 4 tons of cocaine and then created this and helped create this crack cocaine explosion. We don't want to admit to that. And people don't want to come to grips with that. But there's all kinds of information out there that proves that that is the truth. And so when it comes to drugs, we got to find a better way.
Exactly.
Well, Brandon, I really appreciate you joining me tonight. I really enjoyed our conversation. You ever want to come back on again in the future? Whether you're running for office or not, I liked our conversation so much. If there are hot topic issues that come up, you want to come back on, we can just sit down and have a conversation again. Send me a message. I'll get you back. We'll get you scheduled back on. But yeah, in the future, as we get closer to the election, you want to come back on and have another conversation, because the government's always doing stupid stuff, so we'll have more stuff to talk about. I'd love to have you back on and do this again.
I appreciate it. Yeah, thank you. This is the first live recording, like any sort of like live show I've ever done. So this was hopefully I don't look too stupid. Hopefully I was trying not to touch my face too much. I felt it a couple times, and I'm like, well, don't touch your face so much.
I know.
So hopefully I wasn't too bad.
No, it was, dude, I look like I'm Italian. My hands are going all over the place when I'm talking, and I'm the host. I want to say, I'm not 100% sure, but I think Andy Maidment pointed you in my direction. If I found you on Twitter, or Andy might have pointed you my way. Andy ran in 2022 for Congress out of the Libertarian Party. But I've had Andy on the show a couple times, and I was telling him, it's like, hey, if you know a Libertarian candidate's running, send them, you know, send the names to me so I can try to have them on. And so he might have, I can't remember if he pointed.
I think it was third party. I think he was, at the state convention.
He probably, I believe he was.
So then I think he ran into one of my buddies. I was also at the state convention, but I don't think I talked to him.
Okay.
But if he was at the state convention, I'm pretty sure that he was in front. He talked to one of my friends who was there, and then he put him on, told me to come on here.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I just knew that I didn't find you, you know, just out of the blue. I knew that somebody had, and I was pretty sure, Andy's the only one in the Libertarian Party right now that kind of directs me to other candidates. So, Andy, he was in the live chat earlier. Andy, if you're out there watching still, I appreciate you. Well, Brandon, best of luck to you again. Great conversation tonight. And you know what? I think you're the first guest I've had on that is has read Scott Horton and could just, like, just... You and not only have you read it, you remember it, so you're throwing out facts. Dude, that I was absolutely enthralled. Like, oh, this guy actually really knows Scott Horton stuff. That was fantastic. I really enjoyed that. But
I appreciate that a lot. Thank you.
Yeah, so again, let me know what. Let's put this in. If you go back, if people who are listening on podcast radio, if you go to the YouTube channel. Now, is Missouri MO in your website?
Or no, it's actually Daugherty, the number 4, and then congress.com.
Oh, God dang. Okay. Okay. I'm going to put that web address in the live chat. So it's Daugherty for congress.com. That's the number 4. Daugherty, the number 4, congress.com. You can go to his website if you'd like to donate, or just see what his policies are, and to learn a little more about a libertarian candidate, because, people, we got to get away from this duopoly at some point. It hasn't done us any good so far, so keep your options open, for the love of God.
And then two really quick things.
Sure.
If you don't mind.
Go ahead.
One, if you see Defend the Guard in the Missouri House, definitely step up for it. One of the guys who's I'm part of the St. Charles County Libertarian Party, and one of the guys who's in our county, I'm also really passionate, but he's super passionate about Defend the Guard. So if you want to, anytime you see Defend the Guard up in the Missouri House, try to support it. Call your congressman and tell them that you support this bill and would like to see them support it. And then number two, the person running in Missouri's third congressional district for U.S. House, his name is Jordan Rowden. I've met him a few times. He's a great guy. So if you see Jordan Rowden on your ballot in District 3, vote for him. He's a great guy.
Is he also Libertarian?
He is.
If you would, if you've got his contact info, tell him to find me.
I will.
If he wants to come on, I'll have him on at some point. That'd be great.
Absolutely. Will do.
All right. Well, again, Brandon, thanks so much for the conversation. I really enjoyed it. Best of luck in your campaign, and I hope to hear more out of you, brother. Have a good evening.
You too. Thank you.
Take care. All right, everybody. Ooh. That was Mr. Brandon Daugherty. That was a really great conversation. Really enjoyed it. We went over 2 hours, and that tells you anything. That's how much I like the conversation. Went 2 hours. But anyway, all right, folks. Again, I don't have a guest scheduled so far for next week, but the 26th, Dr. Rechtenwald should be on Skype, and we should be having a great conversation. Really looking forward to that. Again, if you don't already, please check out KEYK, keygatheringplace.com, keyradio.live, and also mofree.org, not mofree.org, molibertyradio.us. Especially on Sunday nights from 6 to 9 p.m. Central Time, Sam and Trish Britton, and Off the Cuff Radio. Make sure you check them out. And you can check out mofree.org as well, but I was trying to go in a specific order. I wanted to hit the radio stations first. Mofree.org, you can sign up for the email list as well, and they live stream at 7:30s. 7:30s? I'm winding down here. 7:30 on Saturday nights. YouTube, Rumble, Twitter. I think, what's the other one? There's several different places you can find that live stream on Saturday evenings. All right, folks, that's going to do it for this week. Thank you so much for joining me. We'll see you all next Friday right here on the Missouri Liberty Report. All right, folks, thanks so much for all of you in the live stream. I hope you enjoyed that conversation as much as I did. Brandon knows his stuff, so that was good to hear. Anyway, take care, everybody. It's been a long conversation tonight. Anyway, take care. We'll see y'all next Friday right here on the Missouri Liberty Report.